Thank you for listening to the Simply Syndicated Federation. For more great shows like these, visit us at simplysyndicated.com.
It's trivia time.
All the answers are going to be either MacGyver or Mr. T.
Oh, my giddy aunt.
All the answers are going to be either MacGyver or Mr. T.
I'm not a dude.
The pee-pee's so confused.
Welcome to the show, loyal internet fans. I'm your host, Jason Hawk, rocking the mic on center stage here at our Trivia HQ in Ohio. Let's meet the band. On drums, all the way from Seattle, Washington, Ro Mantanona.
Oots, 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 oots.
And shredding his custom Fender American Deluxe Stratocaster HSS from Costa Rica, Omar Hernandez.
Sup? Should I say...
Okay.
I was actually bobbing my head with that song, Jason, so kudos for that.
You like that song?
A little bit.
Yeah. And let's not forget, joining the ranks of such legendary Canadian bassists as Stuart Chatwood, Jim Cale, and Fred Turner. Tonight we have Kevin Archibald.
Hey, little known fact, when we rock out up here, we do it in metric time.
I thought you were going to say, when we rock out, we do it with our cock out.
I thought that as well.
Mm-hmm. Oh, my giddy
ass. I thought he was going to say, yes, because they're Canadian, they're proper.
Kevin's too polite to say something like that.
Yes, indeed, and my scar might show. Go on.
Hey, guys, let's get right into some trivia, because we missed Ro last week. She didn't get to participate with us, and I think that she's going to be really good at tonight's rank and file game.
Oh, really?
Yeah, tonight you're going to be playing for some categories. We've got four categories here, one for each of you, plus one to cool down with. And, of course, as we always do with rank and file, whoever gets the highest on our list, whoever guesses the highest ranking item, is going to get the first choice of categories. Our submitters tonight, we have some categories, of course, from PDG. We all know PDG.
Peter Guilliarm.
That's him. But also tonight from Joe Loden, Noel Johnson, and Brian Myers.
Joe Loden, is that a new guy?
That is Professor Pangloss on the Front Row Crew Forum. He's a smart, college, awesome kid.
Yeah, we know him. But the categories that you're going to be bidding for tonight in the hot seat are some potpourri. We have indie video games, which I know you guys love.
Ooh,
that's a good one.
And then Let's Rock, and has it been 4 years already?
Oh my god, that's going to be stuff from 2008?
It's politics.
Be. Oh, good call.
Could be. Could be Olympics, who knows?
There's lots of things that happen in intervals of four. So, okay. You might want to be thinking about those, but tonight I have for you... In our rank and file game, the top best-selling albums of all time, and these are, of course, checked on Wikipedia. That's who's making this list. So I'm going to go ahead and have you, dear contestants, choose. And I think since Ro was not on the show last week, we're going to throw this bone.
Oh gosh, that's like hard and difficult.
Ro, before you guess, I'm going to disallow Michael Jackson's Thriller.
Oh, you bastard!
Because everyone knows that Michael Jackson's Thriller is number one.
I didn't know.
I would have thought of it that, because I was thinking, like, okay, maybe it's a classical or something from, like, the 50s or something, because, like, those older people are still alive that have money.
Come on, that's, like, one of the most common pieces of trivia.
Okay.
Oh.
That one was so easy, I figured we're just going to skip number one. We'll see how close to number two you can guess. There's 9 other albums in history that have sold 40 million copies or more.
Okay, I'm going to go with the Beatles.
Which one?
I want to say that
they had more than one up.
I know they had. I want to say. Oh God, I don't think it's Yellow Submarine. I don't think it's the White Album, or whatever their first album was. I have no idea because I only know it's like the Beatles, and, like those albums. I'll just go with a Yellow Submarine, even though I know that's probably so wrong.
Okay, and Kevin.
I know the Eagles always do well on these things. More's the pity. I'm going to go with Eagles, Hotel California.
And Omar.
Sir Mix-a-Lot.
It's kind of hard.
It really is. There's a lot to wade through.
No, it's hard because I know, for example, probably, I mean, Led Zeppelin, Pink Floyd's going to be there. There's a lot, like, probably... The old rocker Rolling Stones is probably going to be there. But the question is, which album is there? I'm going to go with Metallica. I'm going to say one.
Wow.
The Black Album.
Bold choice. Yeah.
Okay. So here's the thing, guys.
Do we have to take another swing at it?
Chewy chose pop stars.
Your album guesses didn't really do so well. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go by the bands that you chose, not by the albums that you chose. Okay. And I think Kevin is going to rank in number one on this.
Nice.
Because he chose the Eagles, and the Eagles' greatest hits album, their 1971 to 1975 greatest hits album, does rank in at number seven on the list, with 42 million copies sold.
Okay. Mm.
And that would be the highest of the acts that you chose.
I don't like it when they include greatest hits on these, but go on.
Yeah.
That's not a proper album, though, is it? It's just a, you know, cut and paste.
It's a playlist.
Exactly.
Now, Ro, you did choose well when you were talking about the Beatles. Mm-hmm. They're down at number 13.
Okay.
Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band was their best-selling album, 1967, 32 million albums, not too bad. And Omar, you chose Metallica. That's actually pretty far down the list. We're talking about number 24. Huh. So not bad. I mean, that's the self-titled 91 album. 28 million copies. Not bad.
I feel we should have chose pop stars like Whitney Houston or Madonna when I think about it now. But then again, whatever.
Yeah, actually having to pin down the album is pretty tough. So you guys did not too bad. I mean, you really made some educated guesses. The one that really got me going was when... Omar, you mentioned Pink Floyd.
Yep.
I was kind of hoping you would go with Dark Side of the Moon, because that is number two.
Sure.
Oh, wow. Cool.
Number two. So let's just run down the top ten for funsies. Of course, we already mentioned Michael Jackson's Thriller. Pink Floyd, Dark Side of the Moon. Number three is AC/DC's Back in Black.
Really?
Surprised no one went with that.
I'm sure that it's that
some
high.
Of those old rock ones was going to be there.
That really is what clogs up the top ten. Yeah, well, not just rock, but rock pop. Even some like acoustic rock. AC/DC's Back in Black was actually number two for quite a while. Dark Side sales passed it up here just recently, I think.
Huh.
But going from there, Michael Jackson on the chart again with Bad. And then, Ro, there's your Bodyguard soundtrack with Whitney Houston.
That's a good soundtrack. Why are you hating?
That's what the...
That's a really good soundtrack.
Ro,
yes.
Will you sing us the love song, please?
No, I don't.
Pretty sure.
Omar.
That's a recent addition to that list.
You have to step in where Ro fails.
Jason can look for the sound clip of that. I'm pretty sure it's there somewhere.
I'm hoping to translate it into Spanish.
No, that would be awesome.
From there, we have Meatloaf, Bad Outta Hell.
Are you kidding me?
Various artists for the Dirty Dancing soundtrack, ranking in at the number seven spot.
Oh, bullshit.
Bee Gees from the Saturday Night Fever soundtrack, Fleetwood Mac's Rumors, and Shania Twain, Come On Over.
Are
That's
you
the top
kidding
ten.
Me?
Yeah.
Jason, is Britney over Metallica?
Britney Spears? I don't think she ranks high on the list at all.
Or
see,
the Backstreet Boys or NSYNC or
these are back
any
when
of that
people
crap.
Bought entire records, not singles, not iTunes tracks, but entire records.
Okay, so Omar, Metallica, their self-titled 91 album ranked in at number 24, like we already talked about.
Mm-hmm.
From there, it's Guns N' Roses, Spice Girls, the Grease soundtrack, Santana's Supernatural, and then Britney Spears.
Okay.
So you get that nice cushion there
to protect you. Is Vanilla Ice on there? Because last time I read this list many years ago, he was like in the top 20.
No, it was Vanilla Ice.
It was many, many years ago.
Ice, baby.
You know, if we were maybe talking about singles,
that
would propel
him
in. To
the extreme, the album was like up there shockingly high.
Kevin, I hear that you rock the mic like a vandal.
Brother, you know I do.
I think that officially moves us into a need to go to an ad break. But when we come back, we're going to bring up the hot seat. And during our break, we're going to discuss who gets what as far as categories. So we'll be right back.
Want to help us out financially without spending a dime? Get a free audiobook with your trial subscription at audiblepodcast.com/movies, and we get some cash to help pay for servers and web hosting. Pick any book from the 75,000 titles available at audiblepodcast.com/movies today.
Jason here saying, I want your questions. It doesn't matter if you're a seasoned pro or a first-time submitter, this is your chance to be part of the show. Send those geeky trivia bits to ATW9K at simplysyndicated.com today. Welcome back, everybody. Thanks for listening to that commercial. It helps pay for some of our server and hosting needs and websites and all that kind of stuff. If you want to donate, go to simplysyndicated.com. There's a little orange, gold-ish donate button there. Drop a buck in there if you want to. Of course, our shows are going to be free, but we're going to leave it up to you of whether you want to support us financially in any way. If you don't have cash, that's fine. Just go ahead and, you know, share us on Facebook or G+ or any of the other sites that them young kids are on these days. I don't know what they are. We're going to jump right in here with the hot seat.
Hot seat. I miss that voice. Can you bring that back?
You know, I think we can. I think I might even have it up here. Let's see if it's on the soundboard.
Yay!
Go. Oh, God.
Retarded Giant is back!
Since we're talking about music anyway, let's go ahead and do Let's Rock.
Rock!
Let's Rock! By Noel Johnson. Uh-oh. Number one, are you ready, Kevin?
Maybe. Noel, I hope you could like the kind of music that I know about something.
Well, just prepare. We're ready for the trench run. Here we go.
Okay.
What famous song from the 1972 album Machine Head is about the raising of a casino in Montrose?
Wow. From the 1972 album Machine Head. Well, everyone knows that.
A lot more people know that than you might think.
Okay, is this going to be like...
And no, we're not talking about the Bush song.
Yeah,
no,
I know that one. Breathe In, Breathe Out, that one.
I know the artist, but I don't know what the songs you're talking about.
Sorry, can you give me a question one more time?
What famous song from the 1972 album Machine Head is about the raising of a casino in Montrose? And by the way, if you need a little bit of a push in the right direction...
Yes, yes.
Think of any acne-ridden, pimple-blotted, grease-ridden... 15-year-old who's just learning how to play the guitar.
Oh, okay, so yeah,
this is the holy trinity of rock and roll, isn't it? The dun, dun, dun. Yeah. Could that be Smoke on the Water?
It is by Deep Purple. Good
Phew!
Job.
Yes, squeaks on
Kevin
by.
With one. All right, number two, here we go. I need you, Kevin, to tell me, in real life, what is an Iron Maiden?
Oh, an Iron Maiden is a torture device in which you lock a person. It's like a sarcophagus thing.
But... lined inside with spikes. Yeah.
That is correct. And also, Bill and Ted thought it was excellent, but it's not.
Well, not if you're the person inside.
No. Do you remember that? No. And they're like, put them in the Iron Maiden. Excellent!
I do. Yeah. Good job. That's point number two. Number three, here we go. On Michael Jackson's Thriller album, there's a track titled PYT. What does PYT stand for?
Oh, reaching it back for the deep cut. That's Pretty Young Thing.
Nice. PYT. Pretty Young Thing.
so wrong.
Why is that wrong?
Come on, Pretty Young Thing? Really?
Wait, time out.
Michael Jackson?
Oh, I see what you're saying. You're equating it to pedophilia.
Omar, you don't stamp on my childhood.
That's
brother.
A good song.
Yeah, I like Michael Jackson.
I'm just
lot.
Saying, dude, that's wrong.
Number four. What band was formed in 1981 when drummer Lars Ulrich placed an ad for metal musicians in a Los Angeles newspaper?
That's very interesting. I did not know that. But Lars is... I think I only know him because he, like, sued Napster. That's Metallica.
That is correct. Yeah, he's always been very anti-anything... giving anybody anything for free. He hates free lunches.
This is true. Bless him.
Number five, and maybe the toughest one, but also really the most interesting question of the bunch here from Noel. Tony Flo and the Miraculously Majestic Masters of Mayhem was the original name for what very famous California band?
I'm going to go with Red Hot Chili Peppers.
That is right.
I know
Anthony Kiedis is, you know, the front man for the Chili Peppers.
That is funny. Yeah, I know they love, like, the funk bands, like Parliament and those guys, and a lot of those had crazy long names like that, so it kind of spoke to me.
Nice.
You got it. And you got 5 points in that category as well. You aced it.
Rock on.
Wow.
Which I got to say is a lot better than last week.
Shut up.
You flip-flopped. I mean, 0 for 5 to 5 for 0, that's pretty good. I'm almost tempted to wonder whether you have Wikipedia open.
I swear on the souls of the saints. Who is the patron saint of Atomic Trivial? We have to figure this out for next time.
You swear on your fertility.
Yeah, I swear on all my future children.
The patron saint of Atomic Trivia War is Alex Trebek. Oh. Duh, and or hello.
Yeah, okay, I swear on the life of Alex Trebek, my fellow Canadian.
Ro, I think it's your turn. We've got some potpourri, and of course this is from PDG. He loves the potpourri categories.
Oh, gosh.
I don't think you should be. I think that there are some questions in here that you will absolutely love.
Sweet.
There are some questions in here, though, however, to be wary of. So number one, according to the Southern Poverty Law Center, what U.S. state is home to the highest number of hate groups?
Mississippi.
No.
Really? Because I guess my first that I hate the most.
This is a tricky question.
Okay.
According to the Southern Poverty Law Center, what U.S. state is home to the highest or largest, the biggest number of hate groups, the most hate groups?
Even I got that, bro.
Okay, well, no.
Some obvious hint there.
Oh, is it Texas?
It's California.
Yeah.
Ah, I thought it was Texas.
Because they have the most people.
With a hint of the biggest.
Oh. Right. If you've got the most populous state, you're bound to have the most hate groups.
Okay. I was thinking Mississippi because like they're the least educated. Like the fattest.
And there goes our Mississippi.
Speaking of hate,
true. I hate Mississippi so much. I would never go there ever. Like it's crazy.
I'll be honest. When I first saw the question, I immediately guessed Mississippi as well. So you're in good company. Number two. You know this one. I know that you know this one because you have talked about this one and you love this one, but it's a dirty one. What sex advice columnist redefined Republican presidential candidate Rick Santorum's last name to mean, quote, a frothy mix of lube and fecal matter that is sometimes the byproduct of anal sex, unquote.
Oh my gosh! I know what a Santorum is, but the guy, it's like Dave or...
What? Sex advice columnist.
Wasn't it a dude that created it?
It is.
I don't remember his name. All I remember is... Huh?
You were honing in on it.
It's like Dave or Tate or... It's like a really just like basic name. Like anyone can have this name.
It's a three-letter name.
Tad. Bob. Dan.
Go back to D's. Dan, there you go, Dan.
Think Mythbusters.
I don't know their names either. It's Mustache Man and Jin and the trio that no one cares about. And then with Token Asian, Token Female, and Bro.
Okay, gonna cut you off. We're gonna throw it over to Oliver, I think.
Dan Savage.
Okay.
Dan Savage is the
Whatever.
Answer.
Yeah. That's close.
0-2, you gotta catch up. Those were the two I thought you would get. Number three, if you need a lifeline, you might want to consult Kevin on this
one.
In Canada, if you ask for a double-double, what kind of drink are you requesting?
A double-double. A Bellini?
Nice guess.
It's also a very fun sex maneuver.
I love Bellinis. I had a Bellini. The first time I ever had a Bellini was at the Sticky Wicket in Vancouver, and that was freaking delicious.
After reading the Archer handbook, I'm sure.
I don't know. A double-double of...
piece and maple syrup?
Gravy? Is it gravy?
What kind of drink are you requesting?
To give you a hint, it's not alcoholic.
Is it just milk?
You're getting closer. It's actually a coffee with double sugar and double cream.
Okay, like is that like for like Tim Hortons or something?
Nice, yes.
Oh, she knows what a Tim Hortons is. How quaint. Number four. Ro, I need you to list these television shows in the order in which they debuted.
Okay.
The Wire, Community, It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia, and The United States of Tara.
In the order of when they started?
In the order in which they debuted,
okay,
yes.
Wire debuted first.
Good, in 2002.
Okay. It's All Sunny in Philadelphia. What is that?
It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia is next on the list. It debuted in 2005.
Okay.
And it's really, really funny.
Okay, then, Community's only been on for, like, two seasons. And the United States of Tara, that sounds really brand new. So I'm going to say Community, the United States of Tara.
So you're going Community and then Tara?
Yeah,
you got
them
flipped around. This is really tricky, actually. The United States of Tara debuted in January 2009.
Uh-huh.
And Community debuted in September of that year. We'll give you half credit since you don't have any points.
Whatever, I don't care.
So Ro has one half of
it. I've only seen one episode of all those shows, and that was like the first episode of Community, and...
Knowing your tastes, you need to go watch Sunny.
Yeah.
Sunny?
But also take a week off work and watch The Wire. Start to finish.
I know. I want to watch it. Isn't The Wire the one with the Italian guy from Law & Order SVU where he plays like...
Maybe. I don't watch any of those Law & Orders, but the stars of that have disseminated into like 1,000 other shows now, and you can go, ooh, him from The Wire. Ooh.
But isn't there like a gay... Like, isn't it like in the jail or something like that where... Or is that, where's the one about the jail?
Oh, that's
the HBO
Oz.
Show. Okay, it's Oz. That's the one I want to watch,
you,
too.
You should go do that Photo Friday again.
I should.
Number five, and we'll say this one is for all the cookies, since, you know, you're struggling so
I
much
am.
Here. List these albums in the order that they were released.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
Well, these are tricky.
Master of Puppets by Metallica.
Okay.
Shout at the Devil by Motley Crue. Dark Side of the Moon by Pink Floyd.
Okay.
And Mellow Gold by Beck.
Okay, Dark Side of the Moon is obviously the first one.
In 73.
Okay. So then we have Motley Crue, then Metallica, and what was that last one again? By
Mellow Gold.
Beck. Mellow Gold. Then I'm going to go with Shout by Motley
Crue. Yes, in 1983.
Then Master of Puppets by Metallica.
Yes.
Mellow Gold by Beck.
Yeah.
Nice. I think you just did it right there.
Yay.
You know what? I'm giving you double points.
Yay, double, double.
Double, double.
There you are. We'll end you with 2.5.
Yes. Thank you.
So 50%. That's not bad. You'd be making millions if you were in the MLB.
Okay.
But that does bring us up to Omar.
Yes.
Omar, my buddy. You've got Joe's category here on indie video games. And it would be really funny if these were all about Indiana Jones, but they're not. We're talking about independent game publishers. So number one, we'll start with the one that I know for sure that you know. In 2010, Super Meat Boy, what is the name of Meat Boy's girlfriend who is imperiled by the fiendish Dr. Fetus?
Shit.
Otherwise known as the hand cramp.
This is actually a really good game.
Otherwise known as the Kevin Expletive game.
Expletive, like where he's like, because that game, it's so wonderful, but you die a lot.
I think that's
you,
kind of the point,
yeah,
though.
That's the whole point, but you, because like every time you make a little mess up, you go fuck. You start
exactly
like, say,
so.
Cunt. You say words
sorry,
like that.
The swearsies per minute is very high.
I'm torn between either Skin Girl or Band-Aid Girl.
We'll give it to you. It's Bandage Girl.
Nice.
Bandage.
Bandage Girl.
I remember it had something to do with exposed, like, wounds.
Number two. The roguelike Dungeons of Dreadmoor pits players against waves of monsters, including what small bird-like creatures that fight to protect their eggs.
I think I have that game.
I think you do, too. I think I saw you play it once, and exactly once.
Yeah, that's how much I liked it. I don't know, the... What's the name of the bird that picks, like, shiny things?
I don't think that's going to get you anywhere.
No. Okay. I have no idea.
Anybody know this one?
No.
No.
They're Diggles.
Okay.
Diggles.
I remember the little green bastards.
I didn't play that one, so yeah. I've got to entirely rely on what Joe says. But number three, I think you played this one with me. I'm pretty sure that we spent about an hour on it. Name five of the eight raw elements needed to fight off evil in Paradox Interactive's ball-crushingly difficult game, Magicka.
Okay. In Magicka, you have, like, the standard ones. It's fire, ice, rock. I think there was a dark. There was earth. No, earth was rock.
One more.
I remember you could generate steam, but steam was the combination of water and fire.
There you go.
Yeah,
you said water.
Water. Yeah, water, yeah.
Earth, fire, wind, water.
By your powers combined, you are Omar. You didn't get all the names exactly right, but it was close enough. Like, for example, the dark energy that you mentioned, that was arcane, is what they called it.
Arcane, right.
And they did call it earth, not rock. But, you know, whatever.
Well, you threw rocks. That's what you did with
yeah.
the dark power.
Exactly. It was fire, water, earth, electricity, cold, life, arcane, and shield.
And the networking for that game is balls.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah, it blows. That game would have been so amazing had it been playable.
Yeah, I bought it.
So there's earth and fire, but no wind? That sucks.
I was jamming out to some earth, wind, and fire in the car today.
Oh, your daddy would approve.
I know. Number four. Now, you and I have played a lot of Minecraft.
Yes.
So you're going to get this one. Minecraft, by Mojang Studios, is like digital Legos, allowing players to dig for various ores. Name the six ores that can be collected underground.
Okay, so it's...
This one's kind of a piece of cake.
It's iron, gold, it has to be ores, it has to have the name ore? Or just
no,
what special
ores.
Things you can get from mining?
Exactly, that's
okay.
what we're hunting.
So it's coal, iron, gold, Diamond, Blue Lapis.
Lapis Lazuli, sure.
Lapis Lazuli. And Redstone.
You got it.
Okay.
That's all six.
Nice.
Nicely done.
Wow. Glad I didn't get this.
I kind of had a hankering to play that game recently, Omar.
The trap.
I tried it with all the updates to see what was new, and the game crashed, I think. So I just stopped it and just never went back to it.
I've had a hankering to pour some creativity into digital nothingness, and that's what that game is for.
My four-year-old daughter is bugging me to play that.
Is she really? I think you'd do well.
She played it at her Uncle Tom's house. In fact, just yesterday, he sent her a storybook made of screen captures from Minecraft, and it was awesome. He made this really cool little story for her. So, you know, if you got little nieces or nephews out there, you want to do a little, nice little present.
Well, it is on the Xbox now, so that. A lot of people are getting it there.
Number five, Omar, you can get 80% if you get this one correct.
Let's see.
Three popular indie developers were recently challenged to develop full games over the course of one weekend in an event called the Humble Bundle Mojam. Name the developers.
Well, Mojang is probably one of them, right?
Of course. So there's one off the bat. I tell you what, I will give you the point if you can get one of the other two.
Really? Castle Crashers?
See, I'm really bad with developer names.
So am I. I ignore splash screens.
Yeah.
They are there to be furiously hit escape to.
But it's good to know who makes the good indie games.
You obviously
games.
Didn't have a Commodore 64.
It really is.
Can't say I know who else was in that thing.
Help him out, Ro.
Well, I don't know. Is Behemoth one of them?
No.
I don't think so, but yeah. Who created...
Wait. The Team Meat people?
No.
Oh, okay.
The other two are Wolfire Studios and Oxeye Game Studio.
Yeah. No idea.
Neither of which I would have been able to come up with off the top of my head either. Don't feel bad. That's still 3 out of 5. Nice job. Mm. Kevin wins the hot seat for the evening, but let's see if anyone can tackle him in our final category, because we do have one more left over.
Woo! Yes.
It's called Has It Been 4 Years Already? And there was some speculation before the show about what this category could possibly be about. Of course, I never let on until we're actually on the air. But you guys thought it might be presidential or possibly events of 19... what is that, 2008?
You said 19.
You're old.
Aught. 8. But we are talking about the Olympics.
Yay.
It's all about the Summer Olympics here, which are coming up probably when? I don't even know when they start.
The end of July. July 27th.
Oh, that long away.
Yeah.
Okay.
Has it been 4 years already?
Yeah.
Okay. Yes.
It does seem like it has been. I prefer Winter Olympics myself, but... whatever. Brian Myers of Iowa sent these to us. Number one, speak up when you know the answer. The 5 Olympic rings each represent a different part of the Earth that sends athletes to the Games. Blue for Europe, green for Oceania, and what color for the Americas?
Black.
Black.
No.
Yellow.
No.
Orange.
Green.
Yellow. Brown.
You're running out of colors.
Red.
Yay! Go,
Ro.
If you had trouble with that, may God have mercy on your soul for number 2.
I know.
The biathlon, triathlon, pentathlon, heptathlon, and decathlon are all combined disciplines that receive a single medal. What is the total number of competitions an athlete would have to complete in order to do all of them?
Whoa.
Oh, man, you gotta say that.
There's some maths.
You ever say the words again?
Oh, we're not gonna do too well.
So go back.
Biathlon.
Okay.
Yep.
Uh-huh.
Triathlon.
Mm-hmm.
Pentathlon,
mm-hmm.
Penta.
Yep.
Heptathlon,
yep.
And decathlon.
28.
No, okay. No, 28. 33.
I should pipe in some elevator music.
33.
Here.
No, because that's 5.
32?
No,
shit.
It's not, because it's 10 plus 8 plus 5 plus 3 plus 2 is 28.
Here's the thing. We all know biathlon is 2.
Yes, mm-hmm. But that's the
triathlon
winter.
Is 3.
Yes.
Pentathlon, penta is 5.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Hepta is 7.
Oh,
and there's where you're messing up.
27.
And then we have decathlon. 2 plus 3 plus 5 plus 7 plus 10.
27.
Are you sure?
2 plus 3 plus 5 plus
7?
7 plus 10, yeah.
You missed septathlon. Isn't there like a septathlon or something? You missed between
it is
7 and 10. Okay.
And biathlon, yeah. I should say, is winter.
Okay.
If it's a
is it really?
Yeah, if it's the summer, it's the duathlon.
Oh, okay.
Biathlon's
right.
The skiing and the shooting.
Just in Canada.
Numbers.
Just in Canada, Kevin.
We are great at numbers.
We're going to give everyone a point on that for mental suffering. Number three, this Olympic object has been conveyed hand-to-hand by divers with underwater flares and by satellite transmission.
Baton?
No, it's a torch.
Oh, the torch.
It is the Olympic torch.
Oh, torch, I like the baton.
Satellite transmission?
Yeah, I had to look it up too. Apparently, and I should probably Google this to get it right again, but it was for the Athens Games.
Did they use an orbital strike cannon? How did they do
no,
that?
No, they used, if anyone's seen the new Battleship movie, they use
why
those.
Why would you do that?
They use the antennas that they to send radio signals in Battleship, because that movie is horribly wonderful. The radio signals they use in that movie, you can actually physically see it. It gives like a yellow beam of light from Hawaii to the satellite in space to the planet, Planet G. Yeah,
that's
over
something
in,
I really have to
watch. Oh, we're all stupider hilarious for just listening to you describe that.
It's great. It's so funny.
So, via Wikipedia here, remarkable means of transportation were used in 1976 when the flame was transformed to a radio signal. From Athens, this signal was transmitted by satellite to Canada, where it was received and used to trigger a laser beam to relight the flame.
Rubbish.
Yes, I think that they were stretching there.
I call shenanigans. Even though it's a Canadian connection, I call shenanigans.
I call battleship.
Numero foro. The Olympic flame is lit by the sun hitting a parabolic mirror at the temple of what Greek goddess?
Athena?
Overseen by 11 Vestal virgins.
Athena?
No.
Diana?
Aphrodite?
Oh, you're so close. Keep on going up the ladder.
It has to be Zeus's wife, whatever.
Yes.
However. No. It's like something. It's not Hephaestus. It's a.
Give me strength, as Wonder Woman would say. Hera.
Hera. Thank you.
And number five, while the Olympics can bring international cooperation, inspire nationalism, and demonstrate perseverance, 2012 London Olympics organizers realized earlier this year that it can't raise the dead when they accidentally requested what deceased musician to perform at the opening ceremonies?
Michael Jackson?
No.
No, I remember this. It was someone in the band.
Def Leppard?
No. It was the Beatles, wasn't it? It was George Harrison?
No.
Paul McCartney.
Ringo.
They asked for...
Paul McCartney's still alive.
Still alive.
Not really? Are you sure? Yeah. Can you check?
They requested Keith Moon of The Who, who's been dead now for 34 years.
Wow. Good job, England.
I think that deserves a golf clap.
Yay.
But I thought it would be neat, since so many of the categories tonight did focus, or at least touch on music, that we maybe talk about our favorite bands.
Oh, yeah.
And anybody who knows me knows right away, mine is easy.
Is it?
Because I'm a diehard Beatles fan.
Oh, good for you. What's your favorite Beatles album?
I think we'd have to go with Revolver. But, Omar, I know that before we were saying that Pitbull is your favorite.
I will not answer that.
Plus Del Rio?
I don't think anyone likes those bands.
You're messed up.
Jennifer Lopez?
Mark Anthony? Julio Iglesias?
Los Lobos?
Whoever did the Macarena?
Los Lobos. Richie Valens?
Let's see how many Latin American bands can you name.
I think we ran out.
Carlos Santana?
Okay.
Shakira?
Okay.
Selena?
I'm sorry, does Shakira qualify as a Latin American?
No, not anymore.
Yeah, she's okay. From Colombia, which would be South American, right?
No, she's Latin American as well, dude.
Is that how the boundary stretches?
Latin American is all the American people that speak Spanish.
Gerardo.
Oh, okay. I thought it was Central America.
No.
All kidding aside, Omar, do you have a favorite band?
I really don't have a favorite one. I remember the first CD I bought was R.E.M.'s Monster.
Oh, that was a great CD.
Yeah.
With What's the Frequency, Kenneth, yes, and Bang and Blame.
Crush with Eyeliner, or... Crush with Eyeliner.
That was a great album. After that was the Black Album from Metallica, and Dookie from Green Day. I think those were the first.
but hard to put your finger on which you would consider your favorite.
Right now, I've been listening to some Portishead, so I'm going to say Portishead.
Nice.
Okay, nice. We can accept that. That's laudable right there. What do you say, Kev?
Again, impossible task, because it's my music's very seasonal. Like, in the summertime, it's all, like, happy, joy stuff, like Jamiroquai, Fatboy, Rural Alberta Advantage, Beasties, Dandies, that kind of stuff. But the wintertime, I go to people who understand the rubbish weather of the winter, you know, the English. It has to be, like, Radiohead and Elbow, like, all winter long. And but then I'll go like on a rock jag, and it'll be like all Stones or Zeppelin or Hip or whatever, or Funk or Parliament, Curtis Mayfield, that kind of stuff. But today, summertime, today, Cake. Yeah, Cake.
You know, nice. Cake.
There goes my credibility.
Being, Cake is definitely in my top five.
Really? Yeah.
Yeah.
But their latest, like they came up with an awesome bunch of albums, and then a crap load of poopy albums. But this last one they've done, I've listened to like a lot. It's very, very good. So that's who I listen to the most right now, except for the Wiggles.
We'll talk Yo Gabba Gabba right after this.
A lot of that, too.
Ro, what do you say?
Yeah, it took a while for me to figure out, too, but I guess if I were to have just one band to listen to all their music, it'd be Daft Punk.
Nice.
Ah, nice one.
Okay.
They are just wonderful. I never would get... All their songs are just... I don't ever get tired of it. I know most of it's like upbeat with a good beat, but their Alive 2007 album is like the best album of theirs. They basically say, hey, I'm going to take these fat mixes I made, and I'm going to mix them up even better. And you're like, how do you do that?
I like Daft Punk too, but the one weakness with them is that there's a lot of songs that you can't sing along with, and I'm a notorious car singer. Like, if you see me driving down the highway in my Honda, I'm probably like bopping back and forth, and you're like, is he singing to Hanson?
No, you can't sing along to it. If you listen to like Alive 2007, that for the Defunct,
ooh, that one's a great one.
That, da, na, 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 you can hear the audience go, oh,
yeah.
Oh. See, you can just hum it or just scream it without making words or make up your own words. Like, I don't know, I was making my own words today while driving home, but I forgot what song.
But I think that does draw to a close this evening's festivities. So thank you all for joining me very, very much. I want to extend my thanks to Omar, to Kevin, to Ro, our regulars here on the show. Thank you.
Yep.
To you, sir.
Yay.
And is there anything that you guys want to plug or anything that you guys want to say before we go?
Natalie Portman.
A good choice. A valiant choice. We will see everybody with more trivia next week.
See you.
It's Jay from Masters of None inviting you to check us out. We're the comedy podcast that doesn't suck, except for art.
And Mike.
And art.
Totally.
Dicks.
Check us out at mastersofnoneshow.com.
Or on iTunes.
Masters of None. Masters of None.